122 verse 1 says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Well, that doesn't sound very good. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? That's a bit better. The reason we're here is not for us, it's not for me, it's not for you. We are here to give praise, honor, and glory to our Lord, to the King of Kings. Stand with me as we sing.
Easter, and these songs really speak to my heart.
We need to praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit for what He's done for us. I cast my mind to Calvary.
Based on the Bible verse found in the New Testament, as recorded by the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11. And that actual verse says this in the New Living Translation. So encourage each other and build each other up just as you're already doing. We want to do that. We want to encourage each other in the Lord. We want to build each other up in the Lord, that we would be fully equipped by God and encouraged and delivered and liberated. And so there's a few ways to experience this today. Four ways. Number one, if you're a regular attendee of Calvary Temple Church, because we don't just hand mic out to anyone. If you're a regular attendee and you have a word from the Lord for our church, you have a word from the Lord, a word of encouragement for our church, we encourage you to share that now. Secondly, if you're a regular attendee of Calvary Temple Church and you have a shout out of appreciation for someone in our church, you want to say thanks to, you know, Fred for doing the flag ministry or whatever, now's the time to do that. Thirdly, if you're a regular attender or even a guest, today maybe it's your first time, and you'd like to thank Jesus for something, now's the time to thank Jesus publicly for whatever it is that you want to praise the Lord for. And lastly, you can share, whether you're a guest, a regular attendee, if you have a prayer request that you'd like us to pray for, now is the time to share that. So those are the four ways to participate. We're looking for a few people to share, if you would. You do have to share the mic so we can hear you. I'm going to just go with Ann, because her and I talked at prayer, and she has something that she wanted to share today. So we're going to go with her to get the prime the pump, and hopefully this will prime it, so we have a few people to share. Ann.
I just wanted to share what happened at Play Cafe this week. We've been doing it, I don't know, 2 or 3 years now, maybe more, I don't remember. And we always play with the kids. Like, you know, it seems like you have to kind of prime the pump to get them, you know, to interact. Well, this week was different. And you're going to have to pardon me if I get emotional, because I can't help it. They were playing with each other. I know that may sound ridiculous, but when we did the things, like they've got blocks down there, they've got, you can, that kitchen, you can pretend you're making a meal, you can build, you can puzzles, you can do all kinds of things. But it was always us, the adults, that were doing it or helping them or instructing them or whatever. This week, I know it sounds so ridiculous, they were playing with each other without us. And what I mean by that, it's almost like kids have forgotten how to play. They don't know how to do it anymore unless somebody helps with them. And my heart, and not only at that, after when it was finished, we didn't say a word. And but I have to tell you this, there was one little fellow, it was one of Liz's. He had a Lego, and he had wheels on the bottom, and he had this tower thing that would move around. It was like a big, you know, I mean, they used their imagination. You may think I'm totally out of my, but I can't help it. I was so blessed. Now I forgot what I was going to pray about. look, because it's the fact that God doesn't leave out any part of the church, whether it's the kids, whether it's the teens, whether it's the adults, the seniors, he is interested in everyone. And he wants to see them grow. He wants to see them learn about Jesus. He wants to see them become part of this church and learn what it is. I'm sorry, but I have a problem with cell phones. And especially with little kids, I do. I'm sorry. It's like, it was just a total, for me, it was almost like a shock. It's like, they can't play. They can't clean up. They can't do these things. And I'd forgotten about it when I was in the prayer room. The Lord brought it to my remembrance. And I just want to encourage each and one, every one of you. God has plans, and he is moving even from the little ones.
Yes, Lord. And I just want to do a move song here, friends. And I just want to say, you know what's happening? God is making this place a place of safety, a place of peace, a place of refuge. It doesn't matter if we call it Play Cafe. It doesn't matter if it's Teen Games Night. It doesn't matter what it is. It's a place of the Holy Spirit moving and working and drawing people to Himself. God is using this 83 Sydney Street for His glory and for His honor. And I just want to say, I might just preach. Pastor Lawrence says, no. I just want to say, you don't have to worry about the kids running around in the sanctuary. That's okay. You don't have to worry about the kids being noisy. That's okay. Because I thank God that we have kids. Kids that want to be here. Kids that are filling our seats. They're never too noisy. They're never a distraction. Because what did Jesus say? Let the little children be stuck out somewhere out back where nobody will see them. That's what He said, right? Keep the little children locked up in the basement somewhere that they don't. Once they get of age, they come to adult church and they say, I hate this. I don't know what this is. No, no. He said, let them come to me. Let them come to me. So kids are always welcome here. They can yell, they can scream, they can shout, they can dance, they can run. We don't mind at all because we're in the house of the Lord. Do I hear an amen? Okay, I'll shut up now. I'm not preaching today, so I see two more hands. I'm looking for a few more. I'm going to go to whoever's the closest. I got one here, one over there, and one over there. Hopefully a few more.
I just want to thank God because this week I had an anxiety attack that I didn't think I'd get through. But, of course, my husband, being who he is, looked at me and said, well, God will take care of this. Yeah. He did, but also... As you notice, my husband's not here. He's not feeling well. How can we deal with it? He's not very good now. So just need some prayer. Thank the Lord for that.
Yes. Amen. Thank you, Christina. Let's praise the Lord, friends. God helped Christina this week, and He's going to help her again because we're going to pray together. If Pastor Lord can write that down or someone, so we remember to pray because I will forget. Saw another hand, I think, here, and then one in the corner.
I'd like to have a prayer request. My son Andrew goes for biopsy on Tuesday. He won't let you know that he is scared, but he is. It's all my, not like prayer for him, for God to heal him or to find out what's going on in his body. And he needs a touch from God.
We're going to do this a little different. Just feel like we're supposed to pray right now. So if you're right here, can we just agree around Dawn and just pray together? If you're here, anybody that's right here, let's agree together. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You for Andrew's life. We thank You, Lord, that he has opened his life to You, and he's hungry and open, and him and I are in touch often, Lord. We pray today that You would minister in his body, even right now, God. I believe he's at work this morning. He texted me, and we pray, Lord, You would minister in his body. Correct whatever this is that's going on, these problems, Lord, with his feet and his legs and his blood circulation, his kidneys, Lord. You know, God, minister right now in the name of Jesus. Raise him up, God, for Your glory. God, the doctors, have Your way in all of this. We just say, Jesus, You're the answer. Jesus, You're the answer. Jesus, You work as only You can, Lord. We pray that You would be magnified and glorified in this, Lord. We trust in You. Help Dawn as she walks with her son through this experience, Lord. May our eyes be fixed on You, the author, the finisher of our faith. And we pray, Lord, as well for Christina Jeffrey right now. We pray, God, that You would encourage her, strengthen her, help her, Lord, with these struggles and these challenges that's coming upon her, the anxiety, Lord. We pray, Lord, You'd continue to walk with her. Thank You that You're faithful. Thank You that You're gentle and loving, Lord Jesus. We pray for Chris today. Minister in his body. Whatever this affliction is upon him, we pray for deliverance, Lord. We pray for freedom. We pray for victory, Lord, that Chris would be able to serve You to his full ability, God. Minister in his life right now, wherever he is, may he know You, Jesus. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Other hand that I saw was over in this corner, and don't want to miss anyone. If you have something you want to share, prayer request, praise report, whatever, please make sure you raise your hand and we'll get to you.
Pastor Chad, I want to start by thanking you and Laura for yesterday. That was awesome. And Beatrice for cleaning and doing all the setting up and everything. But most of all, some of the songs she done, one about the mountain, and the other one, it reminded me that I don't have to be trying to do things on take it to the Lord, and that's kind of something I've been forgetting of late. And it really touched me greatly yesterday. And I want to give praise to the Lord because things are working out better with things in the family that you know what I'm talking about, but he's doing better, he's doing good. And I just want to give the Lord all the praise for him.
And I really believe that word is for someone here today, friends. We don't have to do it all in and of ourselves. The Lord's the one that moves the mountain. The Lord's the one that does that work. We've got to trust in Him. Not easy to do, but we've got to trust in Him. Sure.
Well, I have a praise report. I have gone 10 years without cancer, and I do not have to take the cancer pill anymore.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I see some more hands. This is great.
Everyone knows that my son David has had PTSD. Well, a couple months ago, his counselor that he has to go to for his mental illness decided that she was going to transfer somewhere else. And we were worried that he'd have a hard time getting someone else. But the woman, God bless her heart, she dug around and she found him someone else. And he had his first meeting on Friday or Saturday, I can't remember just which. But anyway, I haven't talked to him since. But I just want to thank the Lord for this blessing for his sake, and his hand is doing well. It's healing, but it'll be applied before he's, you know. Anyway, and I want to thank the Lord for 60 years.
Amen. 60 years of marital bliss right here. 60 years they've been married. I said, we initiated seniors yesterday, and they said, well, we were celebrating our wedding anniversary. I said, okay, you're excused, that's all right. I saw another hand somewhere. Where did I see a hand? Somewhere? Yeah, don't want to miss you.
I just want to share what I heard this morning. I wish I could take credit for this, but I can't. Everyone knows that Charles Stanley had passed, and they were doing a tribute for him. And he was taught by an older woman in his church. He was shown a picture of Daniel with the lions. And she said to him, look at this picture, what do you see? And he explained, described what he saw. And she said, but look at Daniel. He has his back to the lions and his eyes on the Lord. That will stay with me for the rest of my life. And everyone in this room I know has a trial of some sort, and I just encourage everyone to keep our eyes on the Lord and look at every one of those trials as a lion that God has the power over.
That's right. Amen. Yes, Lord. See another hand down here. Anyone else here before I head up there? Oh, see a hand over there as well. Okay, good.
David's listening on the phone at the moment. He's trying to adjust his medications. It's making him feel sick. So I'm asking for prayer for Dave and also for myself. I talked to the specialist who did my endoscope this week. I'm going to be talking to her direction about whatever the scope found. And I'm going to go to your nose throat specialist and maybe will listen to me. So just pray that both of those appointments that I'll finally get some help with, what I've been dealing with, and continue to pray about my walking. I have to be able to get on the bus and be able to work and stuff, and I've got the other knee messed up, so continue to just pray that I can keep on going.
Definitely. We're going to pray right now. But I just want to thank the Lord for my friend Chris. I just praise the Lord for her. I see her often when we're going home from work. We see Chris hiking her up the hill from the bus going home. And I just love Chris. I just bless her. And I just am so thankful for her heart for the Lord. And that she just keeps on going. She's like the Energizer Buddy. But she's honest here today about these needs, these serious debilitations and difficulties upon her. So can we gather around her? Could a few of us join Jean as well and just gather around our sister Chris and pray for her and pray for Dave as well? We love you, Chris. We love you. Just know that we love you. We love you. And the Lord sees and the Lord knows. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we pray right now. We pray for Dave. I touch this phone right now. I pray for Dave right now on the phone. I ask God in the name of Jesus that you would intervene in his life, in his body, Lord. Bring healing, Lord. Whatever this is, God, in the name of Jesus, may it be gone. May he be healthy. May he be whole. May he be liberated, Lord. Able to serve you with no hindrances, oh God. Minister in his life today. Show yourself to him right now, Lord. May he, as he sits on this call, as he participates in this worship service through the phone, we pray, Lord, that you would surround him with your presence, with your truth, with your power, God. Raise him up, Lord, for your honor as a testimony of your power at work today. And we pray for Chris today, Lord. We pray for divine solutions, Lord, to these problems. We pray, Lord, that there would be a wholeness. These sinews, these muscles, these organs would work together in kingdom alignment the way that you have designed them for, Lord. That today there would be a breaking, a shaking, a changing. This body would respond to your Holy Spirit work. This body would be whole, would be healthy, would be strong, Lord, for the glory of God. Minister, Lord, in this soul, in this heart. Encourage her, Lord. Refresh her, Lord. And may she know your goodness. May she know your love for her, Lord. The plans that you have that are for good, not for harm, Lord. Bless her today. Overshadow her today. Protect her today. Envelop her in your truth and your love and your power, O God. Be magnified, Lord Jesus. Be magnified, Lord Jesus, for your glory. For your honor, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. I feel like we might start a church here. Erica.
Just want to say thank you for you and Pastor Laura.
Thank you.
And pray for everybody that's here and my granddaughter.
Yeah. Let's just pray right now, Erica. Let's agree together, church. Lord, we thank you for Erica. We thank you for Greg, Lord, their willingness to serve for you, their willingness to pitch in so many ways, so many times. I pray today, Lord, your blessing over her and Greg. We pray that they would know you in fullness. We pray, Lord, that you would strengthen them. I ask, God, that their roots of faith would go deep in you, Jesus. Correct them, empower them, strengthen them, surprise them with your goodness, Lord, and may they walk in obedience to you, Lord. We pray for this great request. Your granddaughter, you see, you know all. And we just pray, Lord, minister. Minister, Lord, for your glory. Minister today, Lord, in a way that we never could in decades and centuries. Lord, minister healing, minister protection. And we pray that your perfect will be done in this situation, in this little life. May this little life be a witness of your power at work. May this little life respond to you. Send your word, Lord, and heal this disease. Send your word, Lord, and may this little one know you as Savior. May this little one confess her best friend, Jesus, Lord. Have your way, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Lord, I pray for Pauline today, my friend. Just feel like I should pray for her right now. We pray, Lord, to administer in her life, Lord. You know the needs, Lord. You know that which sits on her calendar, that which is happening in her life, Lord. We don't know, but you know, and she knows. We pray today you would surround her with your presence, and in this moment, Lord, just be glorified, O God. Our prayer is that our lives would glorify you, that our very existence, every single breath, would be used to magnify you and to worship you and adore you. We pray, Lord, that her family would know you, Jesus. I know she's talked many times about wanting her grandkids and her children and her family to know you, Jesus, as Savior. So today, may this be the day of salvation. As your word says, this is the day of salvation, Lord. Today, O God, reveal yourself. Today, O God, may they bow their knee to you. Bless this home. Bless Fred, Lord. Thank you for the work that you're doing, God. We just pray that you continue your work and have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. To you be all glory. To you be all glory. To you be all glory, honor, power, and praise. You deserve it, Lord. You deserve it, Lord. You deserve it, Lord. You deserve it, Lord. All glory. All glory be to you. All glory be to you.
$5,600 for this meeting. Isn't that awesome? So we currently still owe $9,400. We're getting there quickly, which is amazing. You can help by making a special donation, mark it as oil or heating, and we'll know that it goes right towards this bill. What's happening here on Thursday night? Anybody know? Yeah, Shelly's coming. Teen Games Night. We are going to be having our students, inviting our students grades 6 to 12 from 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. this Thursday, April 27th. We have free snacks, group games, a devotional, foosball, ping pong, air hockey, and some card games too. We'll even have some prize giveaways that Pastor Chad is planning. Next Sunday, does anybody know what next Sunday is happening? We are having a delicious tenderloin chips fundraising dinner. We served at CTE and it has mashed potato, vegetables, roll, dessert, and a beverage. If you weren't hungry before, I am now. Get your tickets today from being in the foyer or by contacting the church office by this Wednesday. Ticket prices are $15 each for adults or two for $25 or $10 for children aged 6 to 12. What is the pantry item? How many do we need?
100.
Excellent. 100 cans of meat or fish, hopefully by May 7th, right over there. So you don't even have to do the announcements, I can just let you do them. Yeah. The CT Women's Ministries Executive Election nominations are open, so if you would like to nominate someone for the two-year position of President and Secretary, and they opened on Wednesday, April 19th, the nominations, and they closed on Wednesday, May 17th, there's a box in the back that you can put those in. But the election will be happening in June. Thank you so much for your financial faithfulness through your giving. And it is another form of worship. It's not just an obligatory thing or anything like that. It is another form of worship. And we appreciate that. As you can see with the oil bin, you are all so thankful. If you would like to make a donation to Calvary Temple Church, you know how to do that. You can either do it in this box up here or electronically in those different manners. We're going to jump right into the sermon this morning. We're on the fifth installment of Living in the Reality of Jesus' Resurrection. When you hear the word Easter, ponder this for a second. What emotions do you have? When you hear the word Easter, what emotions does that draw out? We are emotional beings, and so everything that we hear or do, we have some sort of emotional response to, whether it's positive or negative or sad or happy or angry or frustrated. You know what? When I hear the word Easter, I think I have all of those emotions. Happiness, joy, for sure. But I also have anger and frustration and sadness and sometimes even fear because, wow. He ended that for me. Please don't forget teaching note pages are available for you, and I even put pictures. Today we're continuing a five-part month of our April series entitled Living in the Reality of Jesus' Resurrection. We're going to review, celebrate, and worship the Lord through his death, burial, and resurrection. Today is called Despair Retreats to Hope. Despair retreats to hope. We're going to continue on with our exploration of what the resurrection means for the followers of Jesus at that time and what it means for us today. We're going to catch up with two of Jesus' disciples, Cleopas and an unnamed follower of Jesus, as they are on the road to Emmaus. Now remember, Jesus has been crucified. He has been pronounced dead, buried in a tomb. All of Jesus' followers have scattered, and as they were scared and completely afraid and confused, they thought that Jesus had come to save them from the Roman Empire. They were expecting him to set up his kingdom on this earth and save them from all who oppressed him, that Jesus would take charge and rule the world. Now he was dead. Imagine what emotions they had. We're going to pick up the testimony, their testimony, in Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. I'm reading from the English Standard Version this morning. And it says, that very day, two of them were going to the village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. He said to them, what is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk? And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? And he said to them, what things? And they said, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things have happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And so, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. That would have taken some time. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. Verse 30. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Sound familiar? And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And then he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered, saying, the Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you walk with us. That, Lord, in this testimony that you walked with these people as they were grieving and concerned and confused, that, Lord, every step of the way you were with them. Lord, I pray that in the right time you reveal yourself. Pray, Lord, as we look deeper into your word, that we will have full understanding of you. In your name I pray. Amen. Finding hope in despair, one, scriptures. As Jesus walked with these two disciples, Jesus helped them transform their sadness by explaining scriptures. Luke 24:27 says, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all scriptures, and all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. A clue to overcoming despair is learning what God says in his word. The disciples did not recall or understand the scriptures that Jesus had been reminding of them throughout his ministry. They were overwhelmed by their despair and could only see what was right in front of them. Jesus had warned them of the events by quoting scripture found in the Old Testament throughout his teachings. Unfortunately, their personal desires of freedom on earth prevented them from fully understanding God's word. They could not get past that their Savior had died. One sermon writer put it this way. On several occasions, Jesus had predicted and foretold his own death and rising again on the third day. Matthew 16:21, 20:17, Mark 8:31, 9:31, 10:30. But the disciples just didn't get it. They didn't understand. They were stuck in Friday mode. Their hopes had been dashed, their leader killed, they were lost, destitute, and fearful for their own lives. What future was there for them now? Do you ever think like that? Lost, fearful, stuck in Friday mode? Friends, it might be like Friday, but Sunday is coming. Believe that. When we fail to read, understand, and apply the scriptures, we can stay in a place of despair. Jesus explained the scriptures to these two sad disciples. He spoke the Old Testament passages, showing them that he is the theme of scripture, that the Old Testament portrays and anticipates the Messiah. Knowing that the redemption story is throughout the Bible, starting in Genesis through to Revelation, is the secret to the Bible's meaning. Jesus, the Messiah, is not an afterthought. He's a continual thread. Through reading the Bible, we encounter the living Christ. He causes life to have meaning and purpose and can dispel our despair if we trust his word. Finding hope and despair, number two, relationship. Upon closer examination of Jesus' appearance to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, we learn another clue about overcoming the sadness this world can bring. Their despondency did not improve as long as they focused on the problem of reconciling the crucifixion with their own expectations. But as the disciples walked and talked, Jesus joined them and contributed to that conversation. He walked beside them. He listened to their fears and concerns and understood their pain. His presence changed their outlook. They may not have completely seen that this was Jesus until later, but remember they said in Luke 24:32, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? They knew, they just didn't know. Their hearts knew that this was their Messiah walking and talking with them. Hopelessness can result when we major on the negative part of life, and trust me, life is not perfect. I am really bad for this. I am bad for rehearsing disappointments over circumstances, over things I have said, and this causes me more harm than good. Focusing on my problems and disappointments only makes me lack sleep. As I spend time in conversation with Christ, who wants to listen, and as I focus on the truth of scriptures, he lifts me up and helps me see beyond those circumstances. That brings me to the next one, because it moves me into hope, is serving. Jesus dealt with the disciples' misery by getting them involved. After realizing they were in the presence of the risen Jesus, they didn't stay in Emmaus. Remember, they were headed to the little village of Emmaus, kind of getting out of Jerusalem, going to hide out. No, they returned to Jerusalem. And what they do? They told the apostles, they started to witness about the Lord again, that he had risen from the dead. They had been with him. We can only guess why their first inclination was to go to the small village of Emmaus. Perhaps they were so disappointed and disillusioned that they were just looking for another location, getting out of here and starting fresh. Instead, the risen Christ had served them by spreading the great news and telling them and walking with them. And then they, in turn, were spreading more that Jesus was alive. These disciples were sad because their hopes had been frustrated. They were excited to follow, serve, and tell others about Jesus while he was alive, but now they had no clue what was going on. He had died. Their lives were in turmoil. Everything that they thought they knew was gone. They could not see beyond what had transpired in the past few days. They were confused and very self-focused. Jesus challenged these disciples to be involved with his ministry by serving others. Psychologists attest that our minds are helped when we get beyond ourselves and help others. I've heard that time and time again with people like coming in to do different things. I'm so glad I came and didn't just stay home. It's been so good for me. Getting involved with the needs of others helps us when we're sad. I remember when I first moved to St. John. Can you believe it's been over 18 years ago? I was newly married and had moved here due to Chad's job offer of being the youth pastor here. I was without a job and had no prospects at that time. I had left behind my family, my friends, and my ministry position. I was focused on what I didn't have instead of what I did have. The first month, Chad would leave for work in the morning, and I would still be in bed. When he arrived at home, I'd be on the couch with all the blinds closed in my PJs, watching TV, and had done nothing. It took time, talking to God, reading scriptures, speaking to trusted godly advice givers, my parents, and a lot of patience from Chad, to realize that my life wasn't finished, but just beginning. No, things weren't perfect. I still didn't have a job at the time. And I felt like I had no purpose. But God hadn't forgotten me, just as his word promised. One thing that I did find help was serving others, having people over after church to play games and eat pizza, assisting in different ministry events, and eventually finding a job and working at the mall, all helped me get my feet back underneath of me and see beyond my circumstances. Perhaps you have some problems in your life today. Maybe you are frustrated because your dreams have been shattered. Maybe life is taking twists and turns, and you don't know how to cope. Life throws us curveballs all the time. It can be messy, hard, and confusing. Maybe today you can identify with the sadness of the two disciples traveling to Emmaus. By living in the reality of the resurrection, they were able to move from despair to hope, and that they saw that the resurrection was real. Christ can be our strength and peace in difficult times. Anybody heard of Toby Mac?
Yes.
Yeah. Solomon Concert once, it was a lot of fun. Toby Mac is an American contemporary Christian music singer, rapper, songwriter, and record producer. He said that his latest album, Life After Death, was the most emotional album he has ever recorded. I purchased this album and didn't realize what it was until I started really listening to it and digging deep into it. Yeah, I can understand. In October 2019, his eldest son, Truett, died after an accidental drug overdose. On MovieGuide.com this past week, this is what was written. At a recent concert, Toby Mac, his real name is Toby McKean, he was part of DC Talk, for any of those who remember that, he opened up about his grieving process after the tragic loss of his son. The singer said, following such a powerful loss, he didn't have the heart to read the Bible. After a few weeks, McKeon said he spoke to God, telling him, I'm going to give you a chance. Imagine telling the God of all creation, I'm going to give you a chance, he says. See, to have a relationship with anyone, you've got to be talking to them, and they've got to be talking to you. You got to be listening to them, and they're listening to you. He continued, the way God talks to us is through his word, and the way we talk to him is through prayer. So the way I see it, I'm not talking to God, he's not talking to me. Do I really have a relationship? McKeon encouraged others who were struggling in their relationship with God to keep speaking to him and reading the Bible. There's some beautiful things that come with having a relationship with God, he explained. One of those things I've been hanging on to with everything in me for the past 3 years, and that is this. God promises that if you have a relationship with him, he will never leave you or forsake you. During the time of his son's tragic death, he started writing, describing it as this. Immediately, I went to something I knew. I went to write. I was so much pain. You got to know what to know, what you love, and what brings you peace. Immediately, I started writing. I wrote 21 years, and then I wrote a song called Faithfully. These are the lyrics to Faithfully. Remember, this is really soon after the death of his son. This is what he says. It's been a long year. It almost took me down, I swear. Life was good. I'm not so sure we knew what we had. Is that true? I've never been the same man. I'll never feel like I felt before. It's been a hard year. It almost took me down. But when my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you made a way for me. I may never be the same man, but I'm a man who still believes. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully. I've had a hard time finding the blue in the skies above me, and if I'm keeping it real, I've been half faking and happy, they see. I may look like the same man, but at half the man I was, it's been a hard year. It almost took me down. In my darkest hour, you met me, so quietly, so gently. You said you'd never leave me, and you stood by your word, so quietly, so gently. In all my pain, you met me. You said you'd never leave, and you stood by your word. Because when my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. Previously, in a video from Joy FM, Toby Mac said, I spoke about eternity before, but I never really thought about it deeply. Because I didn't need to. I always trusted God. I always walked with him. It was not a question of that. But his perspective shifted when McKeon died, when his son died of an accidental overdose at the age of 21. Toby Mac said that he was thankful for the support from fans worldwide amid what he confesses to being his first real experience with grief. The truth is, he says, I didn't know grief really. I just felt like everything was beautiful and perfect until the last few years. And then when we lost Troy, everything changed and I met grief in the fiercest way. He continued and says, I don't know if I'll ever laugh as deeply. I don't know if I'll ever smile as big, but I can smile and I can laugh. God doesn't take away the cold, but he promises that he'll be right there in it with us. That's what I held on to. And I found him there, or he found me there. I didn't know God stayed close in those times, but I've learned that he does. I really have. Just like the guys on the road to Emmaus, Jesus walked beside them. He didn't leave his disciples and say, I told you so. I told you this was going to happen. He had compassion. He had mercy. He walked with them. He stayed with them until they realized who he was. He helped them see through scripture, relationship, and service that there is hope. Was everything perfect? No. These disciples didn't know what was coming. But Jesus was walking with them. They weren't alone. They could live in the reality of the resurrection. Worship team, I'll get you to come back. Their despair retreated to hope. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that no matter where we are, or where we go, or what circumstances we find ourselves in, that you are there. That, Lord, it can be the best day, and you are there. That, Lord, it can be the worst day, and you are still there. And, Lord, I pray today for my friends in this place. I pray, Lord, that whatever they're facing, whatever their day brings, whatever the next month, year, or whatever has happened in the past, that they will see that you have been walking with them faithfully. That, Lord, our hurt and confusion and despair can return to hope because of your resurrection. Lord, I thank you that we live in the reality of your resurrection. It's not a fable. It's not a tale. It's the truth. You are alive, and you walk with us. Lord, I thank you for that. Lord, I pray today that as we sing this last song and as we leave this place, that we will leave encouraged knowing we don't leave alone. But Lord, you walk with us. Lord, I pray that we would just turn our eyes and our hearts to you. That, Lord, we would open our mouths and talk to you. That, Lord, we would pray. That, Lord, we would read your word. That, Lord, we could have that relationship with you. Thank you, Lord, that you have opened that door for us. We bless your name today. In your name I pray. Amen.